Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. I would like to talk today about electronic design, and this is going to be the first episode, and it's more about the philosophy of electronic design, not so much about how you do it, it's what you need and what are the challenges. So when you design things, when you design electronic products, you have some enemies. And when I say enemies, I don't mean guys with swords. There are challenges. Those are the enemies. So the probably the main thing you have to fight against, is complexity. So when I say complexity, what do I mean about complexity? Every stage in your career is going to be built on top of the previous one. So you're going to build more complex and more complex things. And you get to a point where complexity is too high for one person, or it's difficult to handle. That's why we have tools. So back in the days, I mean, 30 years ago, or even 40 years ago, when I started, things that were very, very simple, transistors, integrated circuits, they were simple, gates, and it was, PCB design was simple. Now into today's design, it's way more complicated. We can't handle this complexity without having the proper tools. So a lot of time, we need to spend a lot of time to learn those tools and to learn the basics and to build on the previous layer. When I say layer, I mean, in order to deal with complexity, we get to the next abstraction layer. So today, when we design something digital circuit, we don't go down to the transistor level. We have some levels of abstraction, so we are here at the describing how the circuit works. We synthesize, then we get the gates and transistor level. They are completely hidden. So enemies, the first enemy is complexity. Now, how you deal with complexity? With skills. So unfortunately, skills are, it's something that you can't build overnight. So it's something which takes a lot of time. So that's why when you design something, you need to make sure you pick the right battle. So if you're junior level, you don't go and play in the senior league. So you need to know where you are skill-wise and don't try to jump ahead of yourself because this will end up in pain. Okay, so you need to know your level. Of course, you need to improve your level. You need to move to the next level constantly. But you need to make sure you don't push the envelope too hard. You need to understand where you are on the learning curve. Something else, if you pick electronic design, you will be always on the learning curve. There is no such thing that you get off the learning curve, because the moment you get here, you will figure out that it's actually more, and you get here, it is more and more. And it never stops. It never goes like this. Even when you retire, there is still something to learn. So you need to be aware of this. And there are people like myself, which we enjoy to be on this curve. There are people which they get frustrated. And I get frustrated many times, but it's part of the process. Okay, so complexity is one thing. Inside this complexity battle, you need to mitigate risk. What is risk? Well, risk can be, I can't finish the job, or I end up with a crappy, you know, design. Or I need to choose part. You get to a point where you need to choose the part that you want to use in your design, right? So there is a risk there. If you use the latest and the greatest, you get caught, right? It's because a company releases a new IC and it's all great and you read the data sheet. Oh, it does everything that I want. But then you realize using that chip that actually, you know, the data sheet was exaggerated and you end up taking a risk. Because it doesn't work like you expect it to work. You make some assumptions. The assumptions, some of them, they're wrong. It doesn't work. You need to go back back to square one sometimes, or just go back a few steps and change that, or whatever. There is a risk. So careful with new stuff, because the second mouse always get the cheese. So don't be the first mouse. Okay, so there is a risk when we choose parts, especially a new one. always have, I think it's a good advice. I mean, it's something I did for so many years that I probably can give a little bit of advice here. Have a combination between stable things and risky things. Don't put only risky things. So let's say you built many products in your career, and the last 10, 8, they were perfect or they were very good. I'm sure you have parts that you trust. So use them, reuse them, even if they're not the latest and the greatest. And just add the latest and the greatest for the next big feature. Don't change regulators that, look, this regulator is 0.1 more, 0.1% more effective, more efficient, I meant. Okay, there is a gain, but do you know that it's working? Do you know that it's working under your condition? Do you know it's tested? Is it reliable? Okay, so another thing where complexity starts to bite you in the back is when you build something which goes in very, very large numbers. So you know from day one, this is a product that I'm designing, which is going to be manufactured in 100,000 units. You will discover things after you build the 1,000 unit. You're not going to discover things when you build 10 units. So be prepared for that, right? So how do you deal with that? You choose things that you are 100% sure they work. Now, it's something to design something which a product which is going to be built in low quantities and something else to be built in thousands or hundreds of thousands. Manufacturing is important. If you don't understand manufacturing, that can become a problem because you calculate a second enemy in your design process is economics. So you need to get things cheap enough so they will sell. So because of that, you make some trade-offs or compromises. Now, the moment you make compromises, you know that those are doors for bad things to enter your world, right? So you make some choices there to be cheap. They may look cheap on the BOM, on the bill of material, but they may get expensive in manufacturing. And I know most of the people, they will, if you give them, I'm talking the guys which they judge those numbers in the company or they look at the BOM and say, oh yeah, this is how much it's going to cost. They add they add another number for manufacturing. The problem is that's an assumption. What's on the BOM is kind of okay. From the cost of the BOM, probably things they will go down because you can negotiate better pricing. But manufacturing, it's an unknown. Why is it an unknown? Because you don't know what is going to bite you when you manufacture that board. You assume that, okay, testing, I'm going to test this, testing may become a can of worm. Why I'm saying that? Because you're making assumption, I'm going to build a test rig, I have test points, and then boards, they start to fail. They start to fail in funny ways, and then you need to look into that, and that's your time. You're kind of creating an engineering debt, right? Just look into that and you need to fix them. You need to spend time with the factory. You need to figure out, okay, we should test this the other way around because if we go like this, we get those false failures. Or it's a real failure and you figure out, okay, you know what? I think that I made an assumption here that it's going to work like this, but it's actually not. And you need to modify the test rig or whatever, or the test procedure. This is engineering debt. This is time that you're going to spend and it's for free. As I said, it's a debt and it's in the future. You have to be very, very careful. There is a very good advice in engineering that simplicity always beats complexity. So if you make things simple enough, easy to manufacture, easy to test, they will be the winning product. Okay, now, so the first challenge is complexity. The second challenge is economics. So you need to make sure that you stay on the right pricing when you design, when you manufacture, and when you test. Now, there is another thing which kind of falls into complexity, is if you make something in a very large number and you sell it to whatever industry where you are targeting a certain industry, you might have to go to some certifications. Now, that's an engineering part, the engineering job is more, it's not so much the, it doesn't fall exactly into designing, but you need to have that in mind when you design, right? It might be another person which goes to that, or it might be you, or it depends on where you work. if you work in a small organization, probably it's up to you. But if you work in a large organization, there are people which they take care of those things. But you need to go through all the certification, testing, so on. Sometimes they fail, you need to go back and redesign. Be careful, design with those things in mind, because otherwise you are creating, again, engineering debt. So you need to come back, fix things, go again to the testing, come back, and you can iterate a few times. Now, you can't get things perfectly. You can't get things right first time. Some people do, but complex things, they are nearly impossible. And why I say that? Because you have so many details. So electronic design, it's about details. You have hundreds of details on the board. Every single part is important. Every single characteristics of the part is important. Now, you may reuse blocks where you went through all the judgment, the complexity battle, and you say, okay, I know this, I use this, I've been through that, just bring it here, copy and paste. There is some of that, but there are the new stuff that you introduced. You need to handle complexity. You need to make sure you read all the data sheet. You need to understand how it works. You need to figure out if it doesn't work, what you do. You need to understand how you're going to test it. So that's the complexity. Second, I said economics. Now, the more you add to a design, it will get more expensive. Okay, you need feature. You need those special features. Sometimes they are the most expensive one. Most of the time, actually, they are the most expensive one. And the third battle is actually the third thing in this war. It's time. You can't afford to just work forever on things. You need to move on to the next one. So you have a certain time to design things. Now, designing is a state of mind. It's not like, oh yeah, go there, crank that, you know, handle, and you know, design comes on the other end. No, you need to have the right state of mind. It's not like the phone is going to ring, you know, some colleague is going to drag you into another problem that he has. The boss is coming saying, leave that and just work on something else. That will destroy the state of mind for a designer. A designer has to stay focused, and he has to do this in the block of time. It's not like, oh, I work 3 days here and then I swap to this and then I work another 3 days and then I write an email and then I write an essay about Blue Moon, whatever, right? So you need to put your mind to work. Your sharpest tool in your arsenal is your brain. Your brain cannot work on a million things and swap projects and ideas every 5 minutes. So it's very, very hard when you stop and you go to something else and then come back to that. It's not going to be like that. You need time to readjust. Okay, where I left it? Oh, what was my last problem? Oh, I was reading this data sheet. Where I left it? Oh, I was in the middle of the data sheet. Oh, I need to read again the last chapter to understand exactly where I left it. That's wasted time. It's wasted time and energy because it takes energy. Now, it happens many, many times that you don't work on just one design. You work on two, three designs and they have nothing in common sometimes. Or you work on different projects. Be very careful, because the moment you lose focus, it's gone. It's very, very difficult to rekindle the enthusiasm. Okay, so this is time. Time is important. Ideally, you should have a block of time and finish big things. Like, okay, I'm working on schematics. I'm working on choosing parts and try to finish them. Just because you choose the parts doesn't mean, oh, I'm not going to revisit this. No. Keep a critical eye. Sometimes, you know, making the PCB, you realize, you know what, I don't think this is going to work because, look, I need to route this the wrong way around. So maybe I was better off with the other IC, which has a different pinout, and that will work better on this PCB. It does happen. Or if you work with FPGA, people, they know that you make the schematics and it all makes sense. And then you put it on the PCB and you see that most of your connections are crossed. So you say, oh, you know what? I should go back to the schematic and swap those pins so then my connections are straight. And you do that. And so you iterate between the two. And so it's never done to a level, say, oh, I'm not going to touch the schematic, it's frozen. It's not like that. Sometimes you realize in the middle of design that there is a feature that is not going to work properly. So you need to go back to to the requirements or to the main idea, saying, ah, you know what, maybe I should drop this because I think it's going to create more problems than it's solving. Now, so there, it's a cycle. You go to iteration, you go to mental iteration, not especially. Now, you get the board done, you test it, you find something, you need to respin. It happens. It's not the end of the world. You need to respin fast. You respin, you fix, you check, make sure it's working. Now, the best thing to do is put boards in hands of software guys, early customers, friends, whatever. Make sure there are people which they don't want to fight you. They want to test the product. So they take those boards and they just go through all the, you know, the features, and they use the boards, or they pretend to be the customer and just and get feedback, fix things. Don't jump ahead of yourself, going to your boss or to your whatever. Now, if you're a small shop like myself, you don't have that. But if you are in a big organization, you go to your boss, say, boss, we are done. We have the product. Don't do that. Because they go upper to the guys above them and they say, we have the product. So they set some expectation, and then problems, they bomb out at the grass level. And you need to fix them, and everybody looks bad in that chain. No, don't pop the champagne before 1,000 boards they got to early customers and you see a smile on their faces. That's the moment to pop up the champagne. When you can tell the factory, all good, can you test it? You get good boards? What are the yields? Oh, the yields are good, make 10,000 of them. That's the moment. When you get orders and you talk to the, you call the factory and say, make 10,000. Forget about our last PO for 1,000. Make 10,000. That's the moment to pop the champagne. Okay, so guys, I hope this is helpful. And I'm going to make another episode where I go a little bit more detailed into the design process. This is more like a philosophical email about designing. Take care. Have fun.